We have seen that we have a lot of arguments, especially regarding the insurance, to do disc rather cages. And after this, we have to choose the concept of mechanical prosthesis. And Joël Delécrin has shown to us the advantage and also the limit, we shall discuss this after, about mechanical prosthesis. Our history is completely different because we did not try to obtain to use mechanical prosthesis, but rather to use viscoelastic implant. Why? Because, of course, as it was said, the aim of the disc replacement is to obtain 6 degrees of freedom, and the disc mimics in a way the shock absorber you have in your car. You have this type of movement because there is very often an eccentric load on the disc. And our idea was completely different. It was to try to create a kind of shock absorber. You have here a graph representing the mechanical characteristic and the tensile stiffness of the disc, and another slide showing this mechanical characteristic. And we see that it can be compared to a shock absorber we have in our car. Regarding the creep characteristic also, we see the difference between a grade zero non-degenerative disc and a degenerative disc. We have viscoelastic property, but very different regarding the degeneration of the disc. The stiffness, as this stiffness and those characteristics have been very well studied. And if you look at those graphs, you see that we don't speak exclusively about degrees, but Newton meter, Newton meter, Newton per degrees. So the idea is perhaps the problem is not only to obtain rough mobility, but to increase, to improve the quality of mobility. So it was a dream at the beginning, and it took us since 1994 to 2004 to obtain the first implant. We did a lot of trials, and perhaps we shall be able to discuss of this after, because we did implants like some of the implants on the market, and we had failures, experimental failures. So the pre-market study were done with Loirier in France, 2004-2005, and the first market release was 2006. And since 2006, we have exactly the same implant at the lumbar level. The very first implant were with parallel end plates, and we faced also the same question regarding the adaptation of our cushion in patients where we wanted to obtain more lordosis. The second step has been more recent, 2012-2013, for the cervical disc. So the idea was, in a very humble way, to obtain a shock absorber with a limited rotation and translation, with a kind of resistance to motion. The aim was not to obtain full and complete motion. I shall show you our argument for this. And to obtain a rotation center able to vary freely during motion. So this is an example of our lumbar disc, 6 degrees of freedom, the segmental rotation and translation regarding three axes, and no constraint center rotation. So the concept perhaps may be strange, but it was a technological challenge at the beginning. Regarding the end plate, nothing special. We have spikes, titanium end plate with T40 coating and hydroxyapatite. And we did not use keels. We did not use keels. It can be a discussion after, because we wanted to adapt the prosthesis until the last step of the implantation. So we did not use keels. this induces some precaution post-operatively, because you have rather rigid implant at the beginning, and so to avoid mobility migration of the implant, we need to ask the patient to have some precaution at the beginning of the implantation. So the annulus is made of PCU, very special type of PCU, and we have a nucleus, which is a compressible core made of silicone, and inside you have microballs of isobutane. So the challenge was to obtain this composite implant without any glue. The very first implant, never implanted, but the very first prosthesis were with a glue between the annulus and the end plate. But since the beginning, we did not implant any of those prostheses. We have a geometrical adaptation between the annulus and the end plate, so there is no glue. You see that we have a male and female cup. We will see the interest of this. It is also the way of injection of the silicone inside of the annulus. And our idea was to obtain exactly the same cushion, the same mechanical characteristic at the lumbar level, whatever the level is and whatever the size is. So how it works, you see there is a groove, a very special groove, and you see that there are inner pegs inside of the prosthesis. When you see this, you may think that it is a kind of joint inside of the cushion. No, it is only something to limit the movement, because we did trials at the very beginning, and without those pegs inside of the prosthesis, we had abnormal mobility of the cushion and a risk of dislodgement of the cushion regarding the end plate. So the inner pegs are to limit, to control the mobility. Regarding the male and female cap, they are devoted to the limitation of shock absorption, because we did a lot of tests regarding this, and the risk was to have a collapse if you don't have these limitators. So if you compare the normal disc with this type of prosthesis regarding the viscoelastic idea, you will see that we don't speak of degrees of mobility. We speak about moment, we speak about Newton meter per degrees. You see that we are more or less the same as the natural disc. You see we are more rigid regarding lateral inclination. And you will see perhaps on some of my slides that you can see here on the lower slide that we have less mobility than mechanical prosthesis regarding lateral inclination. We have translation, low, which is controlled by the pegs. We have axial rotation, the same thing, Newton meter per degrees. And axial compression, you see, we are quite the same as the natural disc. And we have what we call elastic return, because our idea was, okay, we implant a prosthesis, a mechanical prosthesis, but we don't control the muscles. We don't control the soft tissue. And we wanted to have this security, to have the possibility when you turn on one side that the implant itself returns to its neutral position. So I see your question. What is the longevity of this type of implant? what are the potential deformities of the cushion? So the big advantage is, industrially, for each of the implants, you have exactly the positioning of the upper and the lower end plate regarding one to another. We are surgeons, we know how we have problems during surgery to be perfectly implanted for superior and inferior end plate exactly in the same axis with the same rotation. And with this implant, which is quite a cage, we wanted to see if due to the rotation, the local rotation, we have deformities in the implant. So there is another advantage of monoblock implants is you can test like this the implant with an equivalent of sacral inclination, 45 degrees. So extreme situation for testing. And you see that the residual deformation after 40 million cycles is very low. regarding stability for stiffness for mass also. So we did not face loss of cohesion, and until now, we are using these implants since years, as you see, we did not face problem of loss of correction. We did also test, because I see also your question, it is PCU, we know polyethylene, way of polyethylene, it is known, but what is a potential way of PCU? So we did, it was necessary to do those tests regarding the potential toxicity for the patient, and we did not find particles in the component material of the prosthesis. The regulation was 10 million cycles, and you see the load of those wear tests. If you look at the literature, there are several papers regarding the wear test, and you see that for some implants, you have a significant amount of wear regarding each million cycles. And we know, perhaps we shall be able to discuss of this after, that the particulates, which is described in the literature, are similar to those described in THP and knee replacement. So for the cervical level, the challenge was more problematic because it is a very small piece, and you see that there is a huge difference between the lumbar and the cervical. You don't have a nucleus. You have only a cushion with a very special shape. You have still the male and the female cap. And you see, we did a lot of trials regarding the shape of this cushion, because the shape of this cushion induces the properties of the implant. But the aim was also the same, to have exactly the same thickness of the cushion. So you have whatever the height of the prosthesis is, you have always the same cushion. We did not use glue. You have also a groove for the adhesion molding of the cushion. But this prosthesis is more sensitive than the lumbar one, because you don't have the nucleus, you don't have the pegs inside. So during the implantation, you must be very careful to implant it with the two end plates parallel. So you see, here are the mobility tests. You see nothing very specific. And what is interesting with monoblock prosthesis is you can do experimentally asymmetric loading of the implant, which was a challenge, because if you do compression in the axis of the implant, you will not have a lot of problem. But if you do asymmetric or eccentric loading of the implant, some problems may occur, and it is the life of our implant. So the same as for the lumbar level, we speak about Newton meter per 1 degree. We don't speak about rough mobility, we speak about the force to obtain 1 or 3 degrees. And regarding the wear test, you see that we had a loss of height, which was minimal and comparable to other implants of the same type. And the loss of weight in 10 million cycles was not detectable. So the potential advantage, you can see this, is segmental rotation and translation, no constrained center rotation, and monoblock prosthesis easy to implant as a cage. It is an equivalent of silent block. So I wanted to show you the history of this implant and to show you the idea, which is completely different regarding mechanical prosthesis. I have another presentation after regarding center of rotation, so I shall illustrate a little bit about the mechanical characteristic in living activity of the patient. Thank you.